How does it feel to be a part of it?
Yeah, it feels really great. There's a real buzz in the room. Yeah.
And how important is it for your film, Spike Island, to be a part of this festival?
Well, for us, it's crucial to show, you know, our film, which is a small British film, at, you know, something with the kind of the buzz and the history and the reputation of the LFF. It's massive.
Now, for audiences that aren't too familiar with the film just yet, can you talk us through kind of what it's about and what made you want to do it in the first place?
Well, Spike Island is the story of five kids growing up in Manchester back in 1990. And their favourite band is the Stone Roses, and they'll stop at nothing to get into their gig, but they can't get tickets. So it's kind of almost like a heist film, like Ocean's 11, about these five kids who desperately want to get over the barriers, through the fences, through security guards, and see their heroes.
So is it all set around one day?
It's set around 3 days leading up to the festival.
And talk me through about the casting of the kids in this. You've got they look from the trailer like huge Stone Roses fans. They emulate the Stone Roses in them, in the way that they look. How did you go about?
Well, the weird thing is none of those kids were even born when the gig happened, which is bizarre for even me to get my head around. But we kind of threw them into like Stone Roses boot camp. They got the haircuts, they learned how to play guitars, we played them the music, we went, took them along to the gigs, showed them all the YouTube clips, and by the end of it, they were diving the ball fans.
Did you introduce them to the Stone Roses themselves or something?
It's quite hard to know, isn't it? Because they came in to the auditions and I was like, you Stone Roses fans? Yeah, of course, you know. And it wasn't until we screened a little bit of the film for them that one of them went, this music's amazing. Who wrote it? It was like, okay, this is Stone Roses music. So yeah, I think they're from a generation who probably are aware of it, but maybe in the same way that growing up I was aware of the Rolling Stones, it's a generation before. So it's definitely on their radar, but they weren't dyed-in-the-wool fanatics when they started out.
Is it important for you to bring back kind of the Stone Roses, you know, back to our kind of forefronts of our minds and for a new generation as well?
Well, we were very lucky with the timing because just after we found out we were making the film, the Stone Roses announced that they were reforming. So it couldn't really have worked out better for us. So I think the Stone Roses are doing a pretty good job themselves of making people aware of the music. But in a way, I think one complements the other. If people go along to the gigs and they're into the music, then they should watch the film and vice versa. If they like the music in the film, they should go and see the band live.
And what like huge fans that are out there at the moment, I mean, what are they going to take away from this?
Well, for me, it's like it's a coming of age story. It's like Stand By Me. It's like all those films that I watched, like The Goonies and stuff, growing up. You know, real coming of age stories about kids who desperately want to do something with their lives, but they're stuck in the middle of nowhere and they don't know how to, you know, get hold of those dreams. So I think it's not necessarily just about the music. It's about wanting to do something with your life and feeling like all your aspirations and your hopes are just out of reach.
And in terms of kind of your aspirations as a filmmaker, I mean, what influenced you and wanted you to get started in film in the first place?
God, there's so much. You know, growing up, you watch films. Like most kids watch films so voraciously. You kind of lap it all up. But I think as I started to realise that I wanted to make films and do that for a living, I was very influenced by Michael Winterbottom, who and you know his all his work and the fact that he was so eclectic. And I was very lucky to later on to work for him. So I think he would be my primary influence.
And how was that working with the great Michael Winterbottom?
Yeah, it was amazing. It was amazing. He's very down to earth, but he's he has an energy and passion about him, which is pretty unique.
And what do you think makes him stand out from kind of all the other directors out there? What makes him so unique?
I think he just he's so determined, and he basically stop at nothing to try and get each film made. So I think, and the other thing really is that his output is so eclectic. So as soon as he's made one film, the next film's a complete reaction to that. So I think what's great for me is I'd love to do a music film like this and maybe do a thriller as the next one and then maybe go and do a documentary. So that's very inspiring.
Wow, so lots of variety. So let's bring it back to kind of the London Film Festival. Will we see the Stone Roses at your premiere?
We'll see. We've asked them, you know, watch this space. I really hope so.
Have they seen the film?
They haven't seen the film yet. We literally finished it yesterday.
Oh.
So
wow.
We'll see. Yeah, I really hope they like it. You know, the film is a love letter to the band. So, you know, I'd love it if they came.
Absolutely. And what's coming up next for you?
I'm very, very much hoping to do a film called GB84, which is an adaptation of David Peace's novel. He's the guy who did Red Riding Quartet. So it's the next book by him, and it's one of the best scripts I've ever read. So fingers crossed, you know, the usual waiting period to show, wait and see if we get the money. But it's looking hopeful.
And have you got any sort of names that you'd like to cast for that?
Yeah, we've got a long list of people. I'd really like to work with Jim Sturgess again. I just did a film with him, and it was very exciting work with him. So he'd be one of my dream choices for the main cast.
And what do you think makes Jim such an up-and-coming rising star? He's been around for a little bit, though. Right. What do you think kind of makes him so special?
Jim just feels very real to me. I think there tends to be a kind of, you're either someone who's a kind of character actor and feels very real, is very authentic, or you're a star. And there isn't really any kind of grey area in the middle. And for me, he's someone who feels authentic, but he's obviously got the kind of charisma and the good looks that, you know, enables you to be a star.
He's also very versatile. We've seen him in things like Philip Ridley's Heartless. We've seen him in One Day. I mean, where do you think he kind of sort of sits?
Well, he doesn't sit anywhere. I mean, a little bit like we were talking about Michael Winterbottom. I think he deliberately doesn't want to stereotype himself. He doesn't want to pigeonhole himself, which is fantastic. I think every time he does a big film, he's just on Cloud Atlas with the Wachowski siblings. So then it's like, what's he going to do next? Well, he'll go and do a small film or he'll go and appear in a music video. So I think he's just keen to keep on challenging himself.
And it sounds like you're challenging yourself too. So thank you very much for talking to us today. And do you have just a message for all of the Stone Roses fans out there that might go and watch this film?
Well, I really hope that anyone who loves the music of the Stone Roses, but even people who just heard about the band and just into the Manchester music scene, come along and see the film. But for me, it's not a film just about the music. It's really about a coming-of-age story about kids.